Welcome to this episode of Digging In, a technical series brought to you by RC Heli Nation version 2.0. And here are your hosts, Nick Len and Justin Pucci.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Digging In. This is a long overdue, but very worth the wait, episode number 4. So pull up a seat, grab a notepad this time, and let's dive into the realm of troubleshooting. Now, first, I'd like to introduce my fellow RCHN co-host and aerospace engineer, Mr. Justin Pucci. Justin, how you doing, man?
Doing well, Nick. How about you?
Doesn't get any better than this. This is kind of what we do, dude.
It is absolutely what we do.
All right, guys. So in this episode, we've decided to name this Troubleshooting 101. Diagnosing problems and failures can be very daunting and an overwhelming task for a lot of heli pilots. And with literally dozens of potential failure points, figuring out what really happened that caused that crash can seem almost impossible at times. So in this episode, our goal is not to diagnose your helicopter for you, but rather to help teach you the tools needed to accurately and efficiently diagnose any potential issue you may have. So Justin, what do you think, man? Should we go for it?
Before we get into it, Nick, what I really want to emphasize for the listeners is that everyone solves problems differently. Everyone has a different way of thinking about the problem and the possible causes. Everyone has a different way of approaching the process in general. What Nick and I are going to be able to do here today is provide you guys with the tools to solve the problem, but in an order that we typically apply them. And that doesn't mean that you can't take those tools and rearrange them or adapt them to suit your needs.
The root of everything we're going for here is to really figure out and fix the cause, not the symptom. And that's something that I think both of us see in our normal day jobs all too frequently. People go after what they see, what they're actually seeing with their eyes. But in turn, if you do that, you could have the potential of a repeat problem. So we need to take a step back, look at the broader picture, and really go after the root cause of what's plaguing it.
That is it exactly. And a good example of that that everyone can relate to is a story I like to tell about two friends getting in an argument. Justin ends up with a broken nose. That's the symptom. What was the cause, though? I don't want to fix the broken nose. I want to fix what caused the broken nose. Well, it was that Justin called Nick a bad name. And so Nick punched him. So that's the kind of stuff that we want to think about here. Helicopters are very complex systems with many problems that can occur when something goes wrong. And what we need to be careful to do is take a step back and observe the behavior, write notes, and then go at it logically. What that gets to is a process for failure analysis. And there are a couple of simple steps that we're going to walk you through on how to perform a failure analysis. Nick, you want to start out?
I think the first thing we need to establish here is to just clearly define the problem or create basically a problem statement. This is going to be what happened or what went wrong. Now, I know that seems a little bit, basic at best, but it is very important to clearly state, even if you need to do it out loud, what happened? I mean, what happened for me to get here?
The problem with that is that if you don't have a good feel for what happened or you don't state your problem correctly, then you may be going down the wrong path and you'll never be able to solve the issue. Defining your problem statement up front is key. The next step that we take in failure analysis is to brainstorm the possible causes. Again, we want to fix the cause of the problem, not the solution. So once we've got a clearly defined problem statement, we know what happened or we know what went wrong, we've got to think about that particular issue and all of the possible things that could have gone wrong on the helicopter to cause that to happen, to match the symptoms of the problem. And what that then allows us to do is to test out those possible causes, or I like to call them hypotheses, one at a time to determine what the most probable cause is. Usually then that points to what you need to fix.
You know, Justin, there's something that I want to kind of add to with that. We cannot be afraid to take notes. And that's something that both you and I know from our day-to-day jobs. It is absolutely impossible to gather all of this information and all of these theories and hypotheses in your head, organize them, and mark them off as you go down the list, and keep everything straight. I know I can't. If you want to be organized and be a little bit more methodical and keep on track and keep from wasting more time, take a notepad, write down all the potential issues, and then you can actually physically check them off as you go down the list.
And also, Nick, you shouldn't feel rushed. Don't feel like you have to rush into solving the problem. You know, as you pointed out, we both deal with this in our daily lives. As an aerospace engineer, sometimes I feel like all I'm doing is solving failures and anomalies. And so this is something that's like second nature to me. And when I mentor my team or the people that are working with me on these types of issues, what I find most often is that they make the mistake of feeling like they need to rush into it. And when you feel rushed, you make the mistake that you just discussed, which is not writing stuff down. So take a step back, take a deep breath, get out your notepad, get out your phone with a voice recorder, and start noting what you see.
All of that is eventually going to lead us to kind of our final step, which is identify the solution. Basically, what we need to get to is, how do I fix the issue and prevent it from happening again? There's a difference between corrective actions and preventative actions. Now, we might be able to fix what actually caused this particular failure, but what if we could even take a step above and beyond that, possibly make that repair better than it was originally and prevent it from ever happening again in the future?
I agree completely, Nick. That's a very important aspect. A lot of people make the error of only addressing the corrective action or the fix, and they don't think about, how can I prevent that from happening in the future? Or how does this failure relate to other similar items or issues on the heli that could pop up again? For example, if we find out that our failure was that a servo horn came loose in flight and that resulted in a crash, and it was the elevator servo horn, how we're going to fix that is, or the corrective action would be, to tighten down the elevator servo horn better. But from a preventative action standpoint, we know that the aileron and tail servos all have servo horns as well. And to prevent that from occurring in a similar situation, we're going to want to go and make sure that those servo horn bolts are tightened down as well.
You know that I love tools, okay? I'm a tool kind of guy. It's what I live and work with every single day. And I think if we're going to attack this, I'm going to need some tools in my toolbox to start diagnosing and fixing these actual problems. What do you say we lay out a list of these tools so we can gather them all up before we really attack?
I'm a big fan of tools myself. And in failure analysis, there are some key tools to keep in mind. The first one, and probably one of my favorite, is a tool that you may have heard of called Occam's Razor. It's kind of got a funny name to it, but as I explain it to you, it'll make sense. First and foremost, Occam's Razor is a guideline. Some might refer to it as a heuristic. And what Occam's Razor says is that when you're dealing with a situation where you have multiple hypotheses or possible causes of a failure, typically, but not always, the one that is the simplest or requires the few assumptions is closest to the truth. And the reason why we call it Occam's razor is because if you take a step back and you look at all the possible causes and you've got one that's really simple and intuitive and logical sitting next to one that's really complicated and requires a lot of assumptions and guessing, you take the figurative razor and you cut all the crap away, and what's left should be the simple answer. Don't overcomplicate things. Despite what you might think in your own mind is the cause of the failure, let's look at it simply and make sure that we're making logical decisions.
We're not saying that there can't be complex problems because, boy, we've ran into some real doozies sometimes. But the majority of the time, it does end up being something simple. So don't work yourself in a big circle and get all wound up and frustrated when the answer could have been staring you in the face right from the beginning. Okay, so we got Occam's razor out of the way. What's my next tool, man?
The next tool that I like to employ is something called the five whys. This one's kind of fun, but it can confuse people at times. So we'll try to walk through a real-world example. What the five whys is, a failure analysis technique that basically is used to figure out in an iterative sense what the cause of a problem might be. And when I say iterative, what I mean is we're going to ask, not surprisingly based on the name, why at least five times. And the thought process is when you've done enough of these failure investigations, you pretty much find that after you answer why did this happen five times and continue to drill down into the details, usually by the fifth or sixth one, you've got it pretty close. Nick, we're going to use an example that hits close to home for you, buddy.
Uh-oh.
The problem statement is, my car won't start. The first question I'm going to ask is, why will my car not start? Well, the answer to that in this case is, my battery's dead. So there's our first why. Now I'm going to ask a second why. Why is the battery dead? The alternator isn't actually working. My alternator's broken. Okay. Third why. Why is the alternator broken? The answer to that one is I have a broken belt. So now I move to my fourth why. Why did the belt break? It was old and it was beyond its life. Why? Fifth why. Why did the belt get old and beyond its life? Because, Nick, you were lazy and wanted to save some money and didn't change things out. After the fifth why, we've gotten down to the root cause for why your car will not start. Now, this one's a little funny, okay? But we can apply that to our helicopter problems in the same way. Does that make sense?
It sure does. And I think what you might find when we get to that last why, that can tie into that whole corrective versus preventative as well. Just like in that instance, the corrective measure would be, okay, that I should have changed the belt. But maybe preventative, I'm going to say, wow, okay, this, for example, caused me this issue. Maybe there are some other time-sensitive service intervals that I should have done at the same time that I didn't. So I'm going to be a little bit more preventative and do those now at the same time. I'm seeing where this is going. This one is my favorite tool in my toolbox. This is called the on-the-scene crash checklist. Now, this is a checklist that Justin and I have come up with that we're going to go down. And think of it like, instead of the first 48 hours, this is the first 48 seconds. These are all of the items that you need to note and pay attention to when you walk up on the scene of a crash. Despite what your natural reaction might be, which is to go out there, unplug, bring it back to the bench, and then look at it, that's not the correct thing to do without checking a couple of other things first. So we'll get to a point a little bit later on where we're actually going to go down that checklist and walk through those steps. You might be surprised how much more information you actually have when it comes to laying this out on that diagnosing trouble tree.
You know, Nick, I really am a big fan of the on-the-scene crash checklist. And like you said, over the many failures we've had between the two of us, we've come up with a really solid checklist. I actually like to refer to it as the 20 questions step in the process. And the goal here is to collect data.
That's right, Justin. This is literally no different than a crime scene. And we need to look at it in pretty much the same way.
And that brings us to our fourth and final tool, the fault tree. You've probably heard this terminology before. And if you're in a technical industry, you may have actually used something that you may not have called a fault tree, but you could have referred to as a fishbone diagram. It's all the same. What this is a graphical way to represent the potential causes of your problem. And how we do it is to group the causes into major categories. So, for a helicopter, let's lay out a fault tree. Remember, the problem statement is the most important thing, as Nick discussed up above. But coming off of the problem statement, we have to brainstorm our possible causes or hypotheses. And I like to group those into electrical causes, signal causes, or those having to do with the transmitter or receiver, control causes, mechanics, environment, like the weather, for example, and our favorite, the pilot.
Yeah, I suppose there is that whole pilot factor in there, isn't there?
Yeah, it tends to bite us ever so often.
Okay, I got an idea. Let's actually set up a crash example. How about that? What do you think?
I think it makes perfect sense.
Okay, so let's, let me see. Let's say that, well, here we go. I'm going to use an instance that I have personally had. This happened to me in real life with a Nitro that I had. I was sitting there in a hover, minding my own business, enjoying my flight, and my helicopter gave a huge, uncommanded, hard right aileron roll right into the dirt. I mean,
Ooh. It
was bad, man. It was really, really bad. So let's actually go through this with that scenario and see if we can kind of figure out what happened.
So we're going to start with our on-the-scene crash checklist. What do we do first, Nick? We've just sat there and watched our beautiful heli drive itself into the ground. We're pretty certain we didn't do it. How do we approach this problem?
All right, well, first on my list might be a little bit unconventional, but there's some reason for it. I think you need to be able to emotionally get out what just happened. If you need to yell, if you need to swear, if you need to laugh, or if you need to cry, please feel free to do all those and try and get emotion out of the way. Now, I will give the warning that we want to be quick about it because we actually have some business that we need to get to. But the point of that is you need to walk up to the crash with a clear head. So scream, yell, cuss, swear, whatever you got to do, but get out there to the crash without any emotion involved in it because it's time to diagnose.
I'm on board with that, Nick, and I have done that many times. Sometimes it's not quick, though, just depending on how bad the crash is.
That's fair enough.
So once we get that out of the way and we're calm and level-headed, what we need to do is establish the safety factor. What I mean by that is you've just had a very large, very dangerous machine crash. It could have crashed close to you, or it could have crashed far away from you. The engine may still be running in the case of a fuel helicopter, or in an electric, if the crash was bad enough, you may have damaged one or more of the battery packs that are on board. And those batteries could be smoking, could be burning or may be in an unstable condition where if you shift something unknowingly, you could cause them to start smoking or burning. The way I like to do this is to approach the helicopter crash scene cautiously, to survey things, and to make sure that we don't have any moving parts. And what I mean by that is tail or head. We don't have any running engines. We don't have any batteries on fire or smoking. Once we've established that, then we can move to the next step. What I will say before we move to the next step, however, is if you do not feel like you can establish that safety factor because the engine is running or the batteries are on fire, maybe it's doing a chicken dance, then you have to take a step back and let it do its thing because we don't want to get injured in this.
Any and all effort that you can put into diagnosing it is nothing in comparison to getting hurt. So make sure, and safety always has to come first in this hobby. Okay, man, so we've established that it's safe. We're not going to get hurt. No one is running the risk of getting injured. We don't have any tall grass or anything like that that could potentially catch on fire. All of that stuff is out of the way. My number one first thing, don't touch it. Don't touch it. As tempted as you are to just start fiddling and picking up and looking and poking and prodding, don't touch it. Not yet. Because we need to locate all of the components first. And what I mean by that is, are you missing any parts? So if you lost your tail case and it's 100 feet away, you need to go find that tail case. Pieces of your boom. Make sure that you have all of your linkages, screws, servo horn screws, any and all. Try and account for every single piece of that helicopter that was on there when you started the flight. Try and find all of those first. If you need to bring the other components over to the main part of the crash scene, then go ahead and do that. But please try and resist temptation to touch the model, pick it up, flip it around, move it, all that sort of thing.
Yeah, that's very important, Nick. And this goes back to what we said a few minutes ago, which was don't feel rushed. The reason why Nick's saying we want to locate all the components and not displace them from their original resting places is because this is where you've got the potential to gather a lot of very useful data. Let's say that the back end of the helicopter got ripped off and your boom and tail case are sitting 20 or 30 feet away. Go find that and look at what condition that's in. Did you have a boom strike? Did it come off when it hit the ground? The answers to those two questions, for example, can put you in very different directions in terms of trying to solve the problem. After we locate everything, though, the next thing that I like to look at is, do we have power to the receiver and flybarless system? This is important because we need to know if it's a power system issue, was that potentially the cause of the crash? If you've established that you've got RX power, the next step is to check for any indications that something's gone wrong. Do you have any blinking lights? Are there any audible beeps? Are there any flashes? Are there any motor tones coming from the ESC and motor? All of that is very useful in attempting to diagnose the problem because, as you know, the manufacturers of these radio systems, power systems, and BECs usually put a feature in that allows you to read an error code. The designers of these radios, BECs, and ESCs usually include error codes in their products so that if something goes wrong, or at least some of the typical problems that could go wrong, occur, so that if something goes wrong, you can check the error code that it's blinking or beeping to you to determine what the problem is with that particular component.
And Justin, that's why it's really important that we have this actual physical notepad with us when we come out to the scene of the crash to jot these notes down, because even though you might not know what those three audible tones, or what those two blinking red lights and a yellow light all mean, we need to document them. Then later on, when we have time and we've brought the helicopter back to the bench, or we're sitting there at home where we have access to this information, we can learn and read and help add that. But just because you don't know what it means right then and there doesn't mean that it isn't of critical importance. So make sure, write it down. Check every single electrical component on the helicopter for those signals.
I've done this more than once before when I've crashed the helicopter, and in my rush to get up there and figure out what's gone on, I didn't take notes. And I remember, hey, the ESC was beeping. I think it was two beeps. No, wait, I think it may be three beeps. So then I go back to the bench, and after all the dust has settled, I sit down and try to figure out what that means. What is the ESC telling me? Well, two beeps is loss of receiver signal, and three beeps is low voltage cutoff. Both of those may still be possible causes based on what other data that I have. And so without writing down what I actually heard and saw, I'm now stuck in a situation where I can't really move any further down that path.
That's right, man, because no data is just as bad as bad data.
With notebooks in hand, we've already looked for all of our lights, beeps, and flashes, and we think everything's good there. What we want to do next is check all of our servo functions. Here's the thing before we start throwing sticks, though, and it goes back to my original discussion on establish the safety factor. It should have been done a long time ago, but if it has not, make sure your throttle hold is on if you haven't already unplugged the main power system. Because now what I'm going to do is check that all of my cyclic servos move individually, so left and right aileron, forward and backward elevator, and up and down collective, and I'm going to check my tail servo as well. What this allows me to do is determine whether any of the servos have been damaged, have they stopped working perhaps for some reason, and this is all very useful data in attempting to diagnose a crash that looks like an uncommanded hard right aileron roll.
What I don't want you guys to do is force something that could potentially be binding. So be smart about it. I mean, let's be honest, this thing just went into the dirt. It's probably not going to be in the best of condition. We could have components wrapped around the head or anything like that. Again, this is just on the scene. What we're really looking for is, do they work? Are you getting some sort of command response from when you move your transmitter stick? Are all of the servos working? Once we get it back on the bench, we can remove any damaged components later on. If you suspect that, hey, maybe a servo has a stripped portion to the gear, I'm not sure if that was a cause or an effect, then you can do a little bit more accurate testing there. But don't try and force something or tear the helicopter apart out in the middle of the field just to check those specific functions in their entirety. Once we go past the servos, another thing that I like to check, and you know, Justin, you had kind of mentioned this before, but I wanted to expand on it a little bit, is boom damage. Boom damage can actually tell you a lot about what happened in the air before the helicopter ever hit the ground. Now, boom strikes, they don't happen for no reason. Usually in order for a boom strike to happen, assuming that we are not flying ridiculously hard and have poor collective management, you will see marks, blade cut marks, or individual pieces of the boom, like it got significantly shorter every time the rotor head went around and the blade took pieces off. When we were out gathering our pieces of the boom, this is the reason why. We want to find out if this thing boom struck or not. That can give us a clue as to maybe we lost a piece of linkage in the air. Maybe a servo horn came off. So make sure that you've located all the pieces to the boom and look for any signs that you did have a boom strike.
The next thing I like to do along those lines is to check all of the gears. And this means the main gear, the torque tube drive gears, the bevel gears, the auto rotation gear. You should even check the pinion on your motor. The condition of any one of these gears could give you the information you need to diagnose the problem. Whether the particular gear you're looking at stripped, or the set screw holding it in place came out and it spun on the shaft, all of that's very important. And also, look at the way that the gear has been damaged. Not all gears fail in the same way, and looking at how it failed may also give you clues as to whether it occurred in flight or it occurred after it made contact with the ground.
That's right, Justin. And the condition of the main gear can tell a very unfortunate and maybe humiliating tale of whether you really did get throttle hold or not. We all want to believe that we did, because that's the correct thing to do. But it just doesn't always happen. And the damage potential that you can have in the crash is exponential to whether it went in under power or not. And that really does need to be taken into consideration when you're looking at crash damage. If the main gear does have a strip section out of it, 99% of the time, you did not get throttle hold. Now, are we trying to humiliate you? No, absolutely not. But what that actually leads to is that the potential for damage in a crash is going to be a lot higher if it went in under power. If you can't find a head link or you do see broken servo arms, it's not particularly, you can't go in that direction of necessarily blaming that as the cause of your crash when it could be a byproduct of the helicopter crashing under power.
Yep. And actually, Nick, that's a great example of Occam's razor. Get that razor out and cut all the crap away. And what it says is, with the observation of the really badly stripped main gear and the damage in the head and servo area, it's probably not what caused the crash. So move on to something that looks more simple and makes logical sense.
And just as important as the main gear is the torque tube gears. Torque tube gears with the power systems that we are running today take abuse, in a lot of cases, above and beyond what they can handle. And tail failures are a horrific way to crash. Tail failures while going in under power are an even more horrific way to have a crash. But looking at those tail gears, your bevel gears, auto rotation drive gear, tail output shaft gear, can help tell a story. If you went in throttle hold, you have highly increased your chance for not stripping out one of those tail drive gears in a crash. And if going through your inspection out at the scene of the crash, you find an exploded bevel gear, that can be a really good indication that maybe that was the cause to the crash, not a byproduct of the crash itself.
Now, along those lines, one of the things that I also like to look at is tail linkages. And what I mean by that is anything between the tail servo and the actual output shaft pitch slider. These sorts of things can fail. It's a multi-linked system, usually with at least one or two bell cranks in between the servo itself and the tail. And what we want to look for is if there are any telltale signs that the more fragile components are damaged, and think about whether that could have been the cause of the crash. And what I mean by fragile components is typically the pitch slider itself and the links that connect the pitch slider to the grip arms on the tail rotor, and also the bell crank at the back tail case. These are usually very thin aluminum or plastic parts that can suffer from failures due to overuse or overstress. So make sure you take a look at your tail linkages once you get all the parts together.
Okay, man. So we got one more on the list. And this is one that you can potentially find, but checking it now will save you a lot of time and a lot of frustration. Take your transmitter, obviously, again, while in throttle hold, and bring up your servo output menu. Depending on your brand, this could be named different things. But what we're looking for is the menu in your transmitter that shows the outputs of all of the channels. Going back to our initial crash, we had a hard right aileron command. Look at that menu and look at the aileron channel. What I'm looking for here is when I put the stick back to center, does the pot center? Is the output centered? Does it match? Or when I'm at center stick, am I showing an output of 34? Well, guess what? If I see an output of 34, or really anything not zero in the middle, within reason, not 1 or 2 points, then I know that, hey, my helicopter was simply doing what it was told to do from my transmitter. So I can't blame the helicopter. That can save me a lot of troubleshooting. We've got a lot of different transmitters out on the market now, and there have been some failures of the gimbals and pots in there. So make sure and check this, and check this very thoroughly, and you can help save yourself a lot of time.
You know, I really like that one, Nick. It isn't something that most people think of. You know, getting back to the crash and the rush to get things figured out, the last thing you're thinking of is that you just had a transmitter failure. So that's a really quick and easy way to make sure that you get that data to either check it off the list or potentially incriminate your TX.
I might be able to tell you this from firsthand experience, but a very poor way to find out that you have a transmitter problem is by trying to, get back on the horse and go fly your other helicopter that you brought out to the field with you. Been there, done that. I don't want you guys to go through that.
That's a bad day, man.
Yeah, it is a very, very bad day. Are we done with the crash scene at this point?
I think we're pretty much done with the crash scene, except for the last most important item. Power everything down, and let's take it back to the bench.
What do you say we take a little break? Now's a good time to go grab another cold one and take a minute or two. Once again, here's Nick and Justin.
Once we get back to the bench, we'll be able to do some further diagnosis. Now, this may require a little bit of help from your buddies to cart all of the random bits and pieces back. But make sure, as Nick already said before, get every last piece at the crash scene and bring it with you, because you never know what those items are going to be able to tell you as you proceed further into your investigation.
Dude, there is nothing better than having an extra set of eyes look it over with you. I have looked at models for hours and gone right over what was, should have been, a problem staring me right in the face. Your buddy walks over, that's the first place his eyes go to. It never fails. So you can never have, within reason, too many sets of eyes looking at it. So we've got all our data here. We did our 20 questions. We did our on the crash scene checklist. We're sitting down. We've kind of calmed down over the whole thing. Where do we go? What do I do with all of this data that I just gathered out at the field?
Well, Nick, this is where we get into the fault tree. We've got all our data. At this point, we've probably already started to brainstorm in our own heads, if not with our buddies, what could have happened. But going back to what we talked about for the failure analysis process, we've defined our problem. We're now going to brainstorm those ideas, and the fault tree helps you with that. Just like the on-the-scene crash checklist, you can have a fault tree that consists of typical helicopter failure modes. That way, you don't always have to sit there and rack your brain after you just saw your beautiful model go in as to what could have caused it to happen. I touched a little bit on some of the major categories of causes, and we may mix that order up a little bit for the purposes of this example. Going over them one more time, we have pilot, we have environment, we have signal, electrical, mechanics, and finally control. So our problem statement is that we had a seemingly uncommanded right aileron roll that caused the helicopter to crash. Nick, why don't you get started on the pilot leg of the fault tree? What could be some possible causes related to the pilot for this crash?
Well, assuming that we're going to put our pride aside and admit that there is a high potential for pilot error in a good majority of the crashes that we have, you know, some of those are dumb thumbs. Did you physically lose sight of it? Was it too far out? Cloudy conditions, loss of orientation, sun in the eye. I mean, heck, you could even have got a bug in your eye. Or, my favorite, did you just freeze? You get in that weird orientation, all of a sudden, brain locks up, fingers lock up, it goes in. We do need to, although it might seem a little bit basic, we do need to make sure and check those off of the list and make sure that those weren't a potential cause in this crash.
I think I've had pretty much every one of those that you just described happen to me at one time or another. But in this case, we remember that your helicopter crashed while you were hovering. And you may not be that good of a pilot, but you're certainly not so bad to the point where you're going to dumb thumb it when it's sitting in front of you and tail end. So let's move to the next item on the list. And again, we're going in order of easiest to disposition or mark off the list to hardest. So the next item I want to talk about is environment. This one's sort of similar to the pilot. All of it sounds pretty straightforward and you think, nah, that couldn't have caused it, but let's not get rid of any possible causes until we know what the situation is. So in environment, what you're looking for is, did I get a gust of wind? Was it completely calm one moment, and then the next moment, a huge gust of wind came and pushed the heli around? And then maybe you got freaked out and made the mistake. It goes back to pilot. Or was it constant wind, and the particular maneuver that you were doing, you just couldn't compensate for that wind, and you made a mistake there? Could it be too hot? For example, a lot of our electrical power systems, especially when they're at the limits of their capabilities, will overheat if it's 90 or 100 or more degrees out. On the flip side, could it have been too cold? As we've talked about in the past, when you're below a certain temperature, some of those soft and durable plastic parts can actually get kind of brittle, and our battery packs don't perform quite as well when they're cold. Last and not least, but near and dear to our hearts, is, was it wet or raining or snowing? Could something have gotten into the helicopter because of that aspect of the environment or weather? So once you get through that, either mark them off or not, we move on to the next item. Nick?
All right, so next on the list is signal. And you know, I want to put just a quick little blurb in here. Don't think that it can't possibly be a little bit of the gray area between two of these potential branches on the fault tree. Justin, you had just mentioned weather and wet conditions, right? Well, what if it's very dry? In going over into signal here, did we have a static strike? Is it so cold, aka environment, and so dry that now we've created a ton of static potential? Did we have a transmitter or a receiver failure? Were you so excited to get out there and fly that you didn't turn the power button all the way on your transmitter? And you bumped it and shut your transmitter off? Or, let's face it, components fail. Did the receiver just die in flight? Did we have a potential interference issue? Did you place your satellites in the correct orientation? Are you flying with enough satellites? So all of those are going to fall under the signal category.
So Nick, those are all really great things to think about. But before we try to figure out whether one of those was the cause, I do want to go back to what you were talking about there with sort of the potential for cross-cutting issues between the branches. Really what that hits on is a subtlety of failure analysis, which is the direct versus the root cause. In your static strike example there, we had a static strike, and that's what caused us to lose the signal that resulted in the crash. But the root cause behind that static strike was because it was too cold and dry. So in this particular case, the static strike is what we would call the direct cause, and the root cause was the environmental conditions.
Yeah, now I see what you're getting at there.
Sometimes you're not going to be able to get to the root cause. Usually, though, if you go through this correctly, you'll at least get to the direct cause, and that's more often than not able to be fixed easily. Moving on to the next category, we have electrical. Electrical actually is a very broad category, and in one way or another, you could probably lump a lot of the items that Nick just discussed in signal into this. But there's a reason why I try to separate the two. When I'm talking electrical, what I typically am thinking of is a flybarless unit failure, a servo failure. Maybe I've got a connector that failed or popped out. Maybe I've got wire that's been damaged because it's been plugged in and unplugged so many times that there's a little stress area that caused the conductor to break inside, or just plain pop right out of the solder joint. Did I have a problem with my receiver pack? Was it fully charged, or did I over-discharge it? Did I plug the receiver pack in completely? A lot of people use different connectors on their power systems, and each of those connectors have a different amount of force required to seat them fully. So think about that. What about my flight battery? Was it fully charged? Were its connectors fully seated? Were all of the solder joints solid and not damaged? And finally, my BEC. Is the BEC still working? Did its wires get stressed and damaged or pop off of the printed circuit board? Or could its connector have come loose? So again, electrical is a very broad category, and you may even think of a bunch of additional ones that I haven't gone over there. You really want to make sure you think through this one clearly, because a good portion of the problems that we see in the RC helicopter hobby have to do with electrical components.
Oh, there's no question, man, that is a very big and broad category. Unfortunately, we kind of have to go next in line with another really big category, which is mechanics. And mechanics can literally be from the tip of the helicopter all the way back to the tail. If it moves or controls something, it needs to be inspected and looked at. Servo horns, linkages, blade grips, bearings, blades themselves, vibrations. And again, there's that line between cause and effect. Did you have ball on the blade grip shear causing your crash? Okay, well, you can put a new ball on that blade grip when you repair it, but maybe the root cause of that was a vibration that you had in the head. So mechanics cover a huge aspect of it. All gearing, basically anything on the helicopter that moves as a result of an electrical component making it move, needs to be inspected. And not just from an effect standpoint, but we want to try and get to the cause of that mechanical failure as well. So I think we've got one, left on the list, Justin.
We do. And that is the tricky category of control. Now, some people don't like to use the control category because, as we've already discussed in signal, electrical, and mechanical, a lot of those items you might consider to be control items. But actually, I try to look at it as a very specific group. And there aren't many that fall into this category, which makes it relatively easy to disposition. When I'm talking control, I'm referring to the specific devices that enable control of the helicopter. We talked a little bit about transmitters before. In Nick's discussion on signal, we talked about the potential for the transmitter to fail, meaning a loss of signal or an interruption of signal. Now, that's possible, but I want to focus on the control aspect of the transmitter, and that's potentially a bad potentiometer. Bad pot in the gimbal would cause us problems. A damaged gimbal could do the same. Or if we talk about the flybarless system, did I have a sensor failure? Could one of the three gyros in my flybarless unit have become damaged? Did I have my sensor directions set correctly? That's another one that a lot of people make a mistake with. And to hit on the cross-cutting nature of each of these categories and the direct versus root cause subtlety, as Nick already mentioned, a vibration may be the root cause to a blade grip bolt or ball coming out, but it also may be the root cause for my flybarless sensor having an issue with control and driving the helicopter into the ground. That's what I mean when I say control. And I'd say that the items in the control category are probably more rare than any of the other ones that Nick and I have just gone over. But again, you've got to keep an open mind and make sure that you use the data that you've gathered thus far to disposition all of the items on the fault tree.
We've covered a ton of stuff, but there is something that we cannot leave without doing. We have to go back to solve this problem. Why did my helicopter roll into the dirt uncommanded? So let's walk back real quick and go through this fault tree, covering the easiest and the simplest ones to check first, and see if we can't quickly and efficiently get through and solve my problem with my helicopter.
You know what the first resource is that I'd like to consult? The on-the-scene crash checklist. We just gathered all of this data, so let's see if we can put it to good use in combination with the fault tree causes that we just walked through. We established the safety factor, and we got mad and swore a little bit because of the crash. And since both of us were there, we had the two sets of eyes that you were talking so positively about. Now, I walked up and looked for some of the missing parts and found everything that we had lost. And in surveying those parts, I didn't see anything too out of the ordinary. It didn't look like your boom got struck, and it looked like you got throttle hold before it went in.
Okay, now I actually went through and I checked all of my lights and listened for any beeps. And again, we talked about this was a nitro helicopter, so I don't have any ESC issues. I checked my receiver. It had power. No warning lights there. I checked my flybarless system, and it was still active and in command. So, man, I got to tell you, electrically, I'm not seeing any issues.
Well, wait a minute. Right here, it says that when we checked all of the servos, the right aileron servo wasn't responding.
Oh, that's right. See? And you know what? I might have been a little bit hasty, and I didn't follow the list.
See, you got to watch out for that, man.
Yeah.
Step by step.
And I even set it down, but again, I didn't follow it. And okay, all right, not going to happen again. I got my list in the hand, and now you were following your list. And now what did you say about an aileron servo?
Yeah, the right aileron servo didn't actually respond when we checked all of the servo functions. So we were moving the sticks around, and all of the other servos were working perfectly fine, but no response at all from the right aileron servo. So what does that tell us, man?
Well, it tells me that that's the direction that I'm going to go in. I'm going to go to my electrical portion of my fault tree and go through the potential issues in that fault tree to help further diagnose that problem.
you're absolutely right. Let's consult the fault tree electrical branch. Now, a few minutes ago, we mentioned what the typical items were in there. Let's talk them through and see what makes sense based on the observations that we made. Flybarless system failure. Now, I think I remember you saying that you checked out the flybarless system and it appeared to be fully functioning with no error codes blinking.
That's right. All the lights were good. I still had active control of it.
Okay, that's great. So we know our flybarless system's okay. The next one on the list was servo failure. Well, that's actually kind of obvious. We've got a right aileron servo that's not functioning right now. But I still don't know what the cause of that is. What we've identified so far, Nick, is the direct cause of the crash, that our right aileron servo was not functioning. But what's the root cause of that servo failure? So let's move to the next step on the list. RX battery. Did we over-discharge our pack? Does that even make sense? Could that have caused this to happen?
Hey man, you never know, but I got a cell checker right here. So I went ahead and I slapped that thing on there. Nah man, I'm sitting at 7.5 volts. I'm good to go.
What about our wiring? Is there any damage to the servo wire running from the servo case to the flybarless controller?
You know, looking it all over, I don't see any vibration marks. All of the wires, I'm usually really good about securing them along the frame lines. I actually even do a little bit of Velcro over them before I zip tie them down to make sure I don't have any vibration problems. As far as the physical wire is concerned, I really don't see any problems.
Okay, good. So we can mark that one off the list. Now, what about the connector? Is the servo connector damaged or not seated correctly in the flybarless unit?
Well, you know, I'm usually pretty good about anchoring my wires the correct distance from the flybarless system. And what I like to do is I'll go ahead and I'll actually use a little bit of hot glue or shoe goo, you know, to make sure that I don't have any seated prop. Oh, dude. Oh, buddy. Yeah, so I might have been kind of tweaking and working on this helicopter the night before, and I think I might have forgot something, man. I hadn't secured all of my connectors in the flybarless system.
And oh, no.
Judging by the looks of this connector hanging about three quarters of the way out, and that connector belonging to the right aileron servo. Oh, geez. I think I might have found it.
You nailed it, man. That's your root cause. Your aileron servo connector came out of the flybarless system. Does that make complete and total sense? I think it does. We were hovering the heli. Everything was going perfectly fine. You had control over it. And then, all of a sudden, the helicopter took a hard right aileron turn into the ground and caused the crash. If we walk through this, let's say everything was seated in there originally and had no issues on takeoff and for the first minute of flight. And maybe, for some reason, because of the tension that you put on the wire, and the little bit of vibrations that we know that nitros have inherently, that connector started wiggling its way up the pins in the flybarless system. It pops out, we lose the connection, and that servo goes limp. So now the force due to the blades on that servo is going to cause the servo horn to droop down, which looks a whole heck of a lot like a right aileron input. And there goes the helicopter.
I really hate to see that, especially knowing that it's my fault. But the most important part is that we accurately diagnosed the problem, and I know how to prevent it from happening in the future. And that is a really, really good feeling. No one likes to guess. We like to be accurate, and we don't like to spend a lot of time trying to figure these problems out. And following this trouble tree and using all of the tools in our toolbox help point us in the correct direction and accurately diagnose the problem, both quickly and efficiently. But I've got one little thing, Justin, that I want to see if I can test you on. You ready for it?
Let's hear it.
Remember that little five whys?
Yep.
I want to see if that'll actually work.
Ooh, that's a good challenge, Nick. Let's see if we can walk through the five whys on this one. So our problem statement is your helicopter crashed. Our first why. Why did the helicopter crash? It crashed because it took a right aileron turn into the ground. Second why. Why did it do that? As we already pointed out, due to the observations in our checklist, it took a hard aileron turn into the ground because the right aileron servo didn't appear to be functioning when we did the checkouts on the ground. Third why. Why wasn't the aileron servo functioning? Well, we walked through the wiring. It looked like all of that was good, but when we got to the flybarless system, it appeared as if the servo connector had been jarred loose from the pins on the flybarless unit. Fourth why. Why was the servo connector loose in the flybarless controller? As Nick already pointed out, he was flying a nitro, and nitros do have vibrations, so we can't blame it on that. But it also looks like Nick didn't have anything on the connectors that prevented them from backing out of the flybarless controller. And now we're on to our fifth why. Why didn't we have anything preventing the connectors from backing out? Because Nick was wrenching late last night, and he made some changes and forgot to use the shoe goo. I don't know, man. I think we nailed it.
I think you nailed it with the five whys. I'm impressed. I wasn't quite sure how that was going to work, and you had me kind of going there for a minute, but you know what this proves? You can't argue with data, and when you have an organized process to go about your diagnostic procedure, it works. I mean, it really does just simply work, and it can take a very overwhelming and daunting task and break it down into smaller tasks that are a lot easier to swallow and that don't get you frustrated. You just go down them one at a time, keep them simple, mark them off on the list, and go to the next one. And you know, guys, that's what we're really trying to do here with this episode. We're not trying to diagnose your helicopter for you. What we're trying to do is to arm you with the information and the testing procedures so that you can properly diagnose it. And most importantly, so that you don't waste a bunch of time doing it. No one likes to spend money on, well, I think this was the problem. Well, I think I need to buy a new one of these, or well, I think I need to go buy a new one of that. That's not the world that we live in, and that's not the world that we want you to live in. Accurate diagnostic can be achieved, so don't be intimidated by it. Justin, any final thoughts, dude?
I think you hit all the high points there, man. I just want to remind people to keep it simple, keep a level head, and leave the pride aside. And if you can adhere to those three guidelines and properly employ the tools that Nick and I have given you in this episode, I think you're going to be a successful troubleshooter at the field. And because we covered a lot of stuff on this episode, we're actually going to offer you guys a tech tip that outlines Nick's and my on-the-scene crash checklist and the helicopter failure fault tree with all of the categories and potential causes that we talked through today. That way, you can bring those with you to the field next time on your phone, on your tablet, or maybe on a good old-fashioned sheet of paper. That way, the next time something goes wrong with your heli or a buddy's heli, you guys are going to be ready to troubleshoot and fix the problem.
Well, Justin, I can't say thanks enough for joining me again. I love this kind of stuff. And I know that you, just as much as I do, love help and teaching people.
You got it, man. This is what we live for.
Oh, yes, it definitely is. All right, guys. Well, this has been Digging In, episode number 4, Troubleshooting 101. Thanks for following along with us, and happy flying.
Talk to you next time, guys.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Digging In, a production of RC Heli Nation, LLC.